Last week, my nephew and I took our pin project to the next level. We 3D printed and laser cut components for over 100 pins for the participants of our summer camps. AlgoLaser played a huge role in this by providing their smallest yet highly capable laser engraver cutter, the AlgoLaser DIY Mini, with air assist and a 10-watt laser head. I'll dive into more details about this affordable and compact device in the second half of the video, including a full review and my overall experience. Every member of my growing 3D printer farm contributed to churning out the plastic components, the Sovo T300, the SU7 Plus, the SU8, and the newest addition, the ChiDi Tech Q1 Pro, which was kindly sent to us by geekbuying.com. The idea this time was to design a variety of shapes and print them in different shiny colors using Conjure Silk PLA from Chitu Systems. We also designed several circular wooden inserts and let the kids at our camp pick their preferred shape, color, and graphics to create their own unique pins. This project beautifully combined the two technologies, FDM printing and engraving detailed designs on wood. It brought so much joy to the kids. I'm Gergo, and you're watching Gergo Print 3D, the YouTube channel dedicated to our 3D printing and laser engraving adventures. Be sure to check out my library of projects, reviews, and tutorials, all with curated, high-quality subtitles. We used Autodesk Fusion to design a variety of shapes, including shields, stars, flowers, gears, and even eye and fish-shaped encasings, and cats, of course. Which one do you think was the most popular with the kids? I'll reveal that at the end. We added the cutouts for the pins. Check out my earlier video for details on all the considerations for the 3D printed parts. Earlier this month, I received samples of Conjure filaments from Chitu Systems. I knew the kids would love these dual color silks, red, purple, yellow, and green, all combined with black for a unique texture. So I fed them into four of my printers to produce every shape in every color. This is an extremely easy print using this high-quality filament, so it's not ideal for comparing the printers. Unless you remember which color was printed on which printer, it's impossible to actually tell them apart. By the way, I have links in the video description to get these STLs and to purchase the Conjure filaments. Each of the 3D printers I used has its own strength. For example, the Sovo T300 with my gantry upgrade excels in startup time, great for prototyping. The SU7 Plus is the most budget-friendly, still keeping up with the rest. The SU8 has a clear advantage in build volume, speed, and accuracy, while the ChiDi Tech Q1 Pro is outstanding when working with more demanding filaments like ABS, thanks to its heated chamber. So, depending on your specific needs, each printer brings something unique to the table. And before you ask, my trusty old SU6 Plus did not take part only because I keep a bigger nozzle in it for printing flexibles and functional parts. We created five different designs for the inserts using Lightburn, each featuring the year and the name of our church campsite. I was thrilled to discover how easy it is to bend text in Lightburn. Just drag this little dot or double-click it to revert to straight text. The DIY Mini from AlgoLaser is one of the smaller laser engravers, which makes it great for storage and convenience, yet its 300 by 315 millimeter work surface is sufficient for almost any project you might want to tackle. I opted for the more powerful 10-watt laser variant, which I found to be just slightly slower at cutting and much more precise at engraving than my 22 watt machine. I cut an insert using my larger 22 watt device for comparison. With the 22 watt machine, I needed to make two passes at 100% power and 500 millimeter per minute to achieve reliable cutting. In contrast, with the 10 watt auger laser, I only needed to reduce the speed to 400 millimeters per minute for the same cutting effect. For engraving, I didn't even change any settings, using the same 2000 millimeter per minute speed and 40% power actually resulted in darker engraving with the offset fill. This is likely due to the better focused laser beam of the lower strength laser. If you look carefully, you'll see that I've already upgraded the feet of my DIY Mini to accommodate a 450 by 450 honeycomb bed beneath the cutter. I'll go into more detail about this modification shortly, but first, let's take a look at what's included in the Algo Laser package. It's quite a large box for a mini device. Naturally, it arrives disassembled in several packages. At the very top, there's a rotary roller. I haven't had a chance to try this yet. We'll revisit this in a future video, so be sure to subscribe so you don't miss it. For now, let's focus on the basics. And yes, the 5-watt power supply comes extra if you've ordered the 10-watt laser variant like I did. There will be another smaller 2.5-watt in the package, but be sure to use this bigger one. Next is the air assist pump, which is not part of the basic kit. While you can manage without it, it's highly recommended for the 10-watt laser variant, especially if you plan to do much cutting. It's also beneficial for engraving, since the high-pressure air can blow away the smoke from the path of the laser beam. I'll provide more details on this later. Look at this beautiful full-color quick start guide. Now, this is the box you will receive if you order the engraver without any additional extras. Inside, you will find the guide for the main unit, a replacement lens in case the original gets too dirty or broken, and a 10-watt laser module. The safety shield is not very dark, so you should still be able to see the nozzle for alignment, but it's removable and held on by magnets. Regardless of the shield, be sure to always wear the protective glasses, which are included in the package. I've laid out all the components here. Since this is a DIY model, I'll walk you through the key points of the assembly process. This is a quick build, made even easier with their easy-to-follow instructions and detailed illustrations. In true Gergoprint 3D fashion, I still managed to make all the mistakes you wouldn't even think possible. You know, I make the mistakes, so you don't have to. We start with the frame, which is clearly labeled A, B, C, and D. However, there are variations in how we orient these extrusions. For example, C and D have the end stops, which should be positioned on the outside, further away from segment A with the big sticker on it. I got those right, but I had to backtrack several times because I initially oriented A and B incorrectly. Pay attention to the holes. The ones closer to the end of the extrusion should face outward toward the front and back of the device, while the holes further from the end are for the feet and should point downward. If you get these wrong, you won't be able to complete steps 4 and 6 later. Also, be mindful of the orientation of the X-axis. The stepper motor on the back of the gantry should face towards the end where the end stops are located, and the limit switch should be positioned near the ruler on segment C. These details are clearly shown in the booklet's illustrations, but I only realized my mistake when I was about to mount the laser head. if the holes are oriented correctly, the seat will be easy to install on the bottom after flipping the machine over. I found it easier to attach the feet to the L brackets first and then secure them to the train. After redoing the assembly for the third time because of some camera troubles and doing some backtracking, I found it better to add the timing belts first and the end plates later. It's fine to reverse step 6 and 7 in the manual. Just make sure to wrap the belt over the pulleys and under the palm wheels with the teeth pointing down towards the extrusion. Secure the end plates using the same M5x14 screws that were used for the feet. This is why we needed to orient those screw holes toward the front and back. Next, thread the ends of the timing belt through the slots on the end plates and fasten them with washers and the M5x8 screws. Finally, secure the limit switch mounting plate using the screw holes closer to the corner of the frame. Orient the switch so that its arm faces outward, like this, so it can make contact with the red plate on the outside of the carriage. Now we can slide in the laser module. Depending on the height, you might need to use different holes on its mounting plate. Next, add the control box. Plug the wire marked L into the laser module, X into the X motor, XL into the X limit switch, YL into the Y limit switch, and finally Y into the Y stepper motor. Please note, the limit switch wires can be interchanged. The switch only breaks them. The 10 watt variant comes with an air assist nozzle and a piece of stiffer air pipe. I connected one end of the pipe to the nozzle and secured it to the top of the carriage with one of the included zip ties. I attached the other end of the air pipe to the end of the X-axis pointing upward with another zip tie, ensuring it was positioned so it wouldn't interfere with the moving carriage. I used a few more zip ties to bind the pipe to the cable harness, making sure it was long enough for the tool head to reach the furthest points of the work area. The air pump comes with a softer pipe. Use the coupler at the end of this pipe to connect it to the permanently installed stiffer pipe. Be sure to always press in the collar on the coupler when attaching or detaching these pipes to prevent premature wear on the ends. Plug the other end of the soft pipe into the outlet on the front of the air pump. Now we can hook up all these cables to the control box. Insert the pump plug with its flat side facing the device. I've added a few more zip ties to the critical section of the air pipe and wire harness. Then I plugged in the power supply. When adding my honeycomb bed, not included with this Algo laser kit, I realized that although the 450 by 450 bed fits between the feet, they are not tall enough to provide clearance for the carriage to move. We'll address this shortly. For now, the aluminum plate will be sufficient to protect my desk during engraving. Before we turn on the device, a quick word on safety. When using any laser engraver, always wear the protective glasses included in the package. This is crucial because the laser beam can cause serious eye damage, even from reflections. Long press the single button on the control box to power on. Everything seems to be moving correctly. I connected it to my Windows 10 PC using the USB cable since I couldn't find specific light burn profiles for the DIY Mini on Algo Laser's website. I initially added a generic GRBL device in light burn. The only setting we need to enter is the work area dimensions, 300 by 315 millimeters for Y. The software connected to the DIY Mini and worked fine, but I encountered an issue with controlling the air assist pump. While the M8 command turned on the pump correctly, M9 didn't seem to turn it off. After checking the air pump's manual and doing some experimentation, I discovered that the command M17S0 is required to turn it off. To configure this in Lightburn, we'll need to re-add the AlgoLaser DIY Mini as a custom G-code device. In this setup, besides the dimensions, you can define a few other characteristics, but I just kept all the defaults for these. Next, go to Edit Device Settings, and on the Custom G-code tab, set the Air Assist on and off commands. I ended up using M16S1000 to turn it on at 100%. You can reduce the S value if you want, and M17S0 to turn it off. With these settings, my quick engraving tests were successful. I spent a few minutes designing a set of taller feet to accommodate my honeycomb bed. The original feet use M6 threads for both the rubber feet and attachment to the frame. My simple design requires 4 M6x20 bolts and 4 nuts. I decided to pin them using the Black Creality Hyper ABS I got from geekbuying.com with my new GD Tech U1 Pro. Please note, if you're working with 3D printers, especially with materials like ABS, proper ventilation is key to keeping your space safe. I never stay in the room when printing ABS or ASA, and you could see in my reflections that I'm wearing a protective mask even when I visit the printer to film its progress, always keeping windows open and the doors of the room closed. The Q1 Pro excels at printing ABS in its heated chamber, and this Creality Hyper ABS is perfect for the high speeds the GD printer is capable of, while being safer and much less smelly than other ABS filaments I've used. Though ABS is ideal for this purpose, using PETG or even PLA would have also sufficed for these risers. Big thanks to geekbuying.com for providing this printer and materials. My next video will be dedicated to reviewing them. You can find links and coupon codes for this filament and the GD Tech U1 Pro printer in the description below. While the foot risers were printing, I moved the DIY Mini to my porch. See, many of these entry-level engravers come without enclosures or smoke extractors. We must always ensure our workspace is well ventilated to avoid inhaling fumes from burnt materials. Wood might smell nice, but it's bad for you. Next, we set the distance from the material using the Focus Assist puck that came in the package and conducted an engraving test in Lightburn. I set the power to vary from 10% to 100% and the speed from 500 to 5000 millimeter per minute. I was pleasantly surprised how powerful this 10 watt laser is. At 500 millimeter per minute, even 80% power was sufficient to cut all the way through the 3.5 millimeter plywood in offset fill mode. Based on this engraving test, I'll use 40% power and 2000 millimeter per minute speed for future engravings. So, when should we consider a more powerful laser? If you're planning to cut through thicker materials or work on more professional grade projects, a higher wattage laser like my 22 watt might be worth the investment. However, for hobbyists or those just starting out, the 10 watt DIY Mini is more than capable of handling a wide variety of tasks with precision and ease, just at a slightly slower speed. The feet are done. Though they stuck to the Q1 Pro's build plate a bit too well, this might be because I printed PETG before ABS, but the PI surface survived with only minor wear. I'm still glad this printer came with a double-sided PI sheet. ABS sticks so well that I likely need to use the included glue stick in the future. I added the feet and they fit like a glove. Or, considering we are talking about feet, maybe I should say they fit like a sock. Anyway, I made the STLs available on my Cult 3D account. The links are in the description below. With the raised feet, we can now use the honeycomb bed. Mine came from geekbuying.com, but you can find the same size bed in Algo Laser's webshop as well. Both links are in the description below. While resetting the focus distance, I realized that the included focus assist pack can be used even without the safety shield. Just use its full height. By the way, I measured both sizes and will include a reprintable STL in the same Cults 3D project where the foot risers are. The cut test also showed encouraging results. I'll be able to cut this 3.5mm plywood at 300mm/min, but for reliability, I'll set it to 2 passes at 400mm/min. I'll let you watch how the pins for our cams were engraved and cut while I share my first impressions of the DIY Mini from Algo Laser. And let's start with the positives. There are lots of them. You get a complete working system at an affordable price with good upgrade options for stronger lasers, air assists, and even rotary rollers. The small footprint makes it convenient for any workshop or even home, yet it provides enough work area for almost any project. The assembly process is well documented and straightforward, with only a few caveats that I highlighted earlier. The cables are thoughtfully designed, not too short, not too long, just right. The motion system is solid and tight, with no give or wobble. The gantry moves smoothly in both directions. Connecting to a PC via USB was problem-free. I haven't tested the optional Wi-Fi connection yet, but I'll cover that in a follow-up video. I was pleasantly surprised by the strength of the 10-watt laser, which not only engraves, but also cuts wood quite well. I'll test more materials in my next video. The removable magnetic safety shield makes the material alignment easier, and I appreciate that the focus assist can be used without the shield as well. As with any device, there are some negatives. I'm not thrilled with the focus system. I prefer the fold-out type, even though I sometimes forget to fold them up before starting the engraving job. The focus assist pack can be easily misplaced or lost, and those with 3D printers can print the replacement using my STL, but the fold-down type is more convenient in my opinion. While it's great that the device is compatible with Lightburn and Laser GRBL, I couldn't find a specific Lightburn profile on Algo Laser's website. Additionally, the slight non-standard air assist controls needed manual configuration, which could be difficult for someone beginning this hobby. However, with the settings I've shared, you can now set them up quickly and easily. The installation of the air assist pipe required some creativity due to the lack of specific instructions for the DIY Mini. However, you can now follow the solutions I've provided here. The simple single button operation is nice for beginners, but I would have preferred a dedicated emergency stop button to quickly halt the operations if something goes wrong. Long pressing the power button for 3 seconds to turn off the device isn't ideal from a safety perspective. I recommend plugging the device into a switchable power strip and using that to quickly cut power if needed. All in all, despite these easily correctable caveats, I can recommend the DIY Mini as a great entry into laser engraving and even laser cutting. This model is currently on sale at pretty good discounts on both Algo Laser's website and Amazon. Please use my affiliate links in the description to let them know I helped you choose this great device. Use the coupon code in the description to save $36 on Amazon. I will keep the links up to date with coupon codes if new ones become available. The kids at our camp were thrilled with the pins. The laser cut pieces fit perfectly into the various fun 3D printed cases, and even the youngest campers had instant success assembling the unique pins they chose. And yes, the flower and sun shapes were their favorites. Check out my Coles 3D profile for all these designs as well. You can easily customize the text or graphics in Lightburn and adjust the case depth in your slicer for your specific material. I'm very curious. Please let me know in the comments below if this project piqued your interest. You can create pins for your business, your church, or even just a group of friends. Besides wearing them on your shirts, they look great on bags or backpacks too. If you post any pictures of your designs in social media, please be sure to tag them with hashtag GergoPrint3D so I can find them. As I've teased several times, my next video will be a review of the Chidi Tech Q1 Pro from geekbuying.com, comparing it to my Sovos. Be sure to subscribe so you'll be notified when it drops. For more information about the pins, watch this video. For more 3D printing content, check out this playlist. But either way, be sure to go print 3D. And yes, you're awesome for watching another GergoPrint 3D video all the way to the end. Thank you.